approximately 10:05 on Wednesday morning, the 13th of October. Roll call, Brent.
Commission members Brown.
Present.
Fuller.
Present.
Capel. Greer.
Present.
Harris.
Present.
Vice Chair Smith.
Here.
Chairman Vieira.
Present.
We have a quorum.
Thank you. Mr. Fuller, would you like to lead us in the pledge, please?
Please rise, face the flag, and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Hey, with our first presentation, Commissioner Greer, would you like to make introductions, please?
Okay. I had asked if the Westside Union School District would come and present just briefly the program, the Not in Our Town anti-bullying program. There's going to be an event here in Lancaster at the Performing Arts Center in the next 30 days, and I'll let them tell you all about it. For commission members that weren't here last year when this was initially brought to the Criminal Justice Commission, it's a terrific program. We've seen it here in the council chambers, and it's terrific in the community. And it happens to be a subject that if you turn the news on every night, it's on the news now. And it's just, I think it's worth us hearing about again, especially with the upcoming event. So with that, I think we'll probably start out with Gina Rasal from the Westside Union School District.
Good morning, and thank you for inviting us here today. I'm Gina Rossell, superintendent of the Westside Union School District, and we appreciate the opportunity to share what we think is a wonderful opportunity for our community to take a stand against bullying. First, I'd like to thank Councilmember Crist for bringing us into meet with you last year once he saw our program, and Commissioner Smith for hooking us up with the mayor, who came out to look at our program, take a look at the statistics that have reflected what a powerful program this is in terms of helping kids feel safe at school. So thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to be here today. We will be having Anti-Bullying Week in the city of Lancaster beginning the 15th of November. We've been fortunate enough to get 20 schools to partner with us. Program started as a project at Delser School of our True Leaders, and they have done a wonderful job, as you're going to see, in trying to get kids to understand that bullying has no place anywhere, and that it is our job to take a stand and proactively help stamp it out. So I'm going to introduce a couple of folks that will be the primary presenters of our program today. Lori Massari, who I have to tell you I'm extremely proud of. She's a counselor with Delser School, been with us for 3 years, and very creative, took on this project. As we said, we want to do some things that really changed the dynamic in our school district, and Lori has just done a fabulous job, so Lori. And Nick Finks, who's a freshman at Quartz Hill High School, but was a student at Delser School, who's taken a student leadership role, Nick, and they will present our program today. Thank you.
And I would like to thank Gina Rossell, our superintendent, for standing behind this program, making it possible, inspiring me to want to do the work involved in making this project happen. Things like this happen because of leadership that starts at the top and trickles all the way down. And I can honestly say that if it were not for Gina, I would not be doing this project. So thank you, Gina. As you remember, last year we came here and we did our presentation in this council chamber. And since doing that, we've received so much support from this community. And I felt that in some way we needed to continue to respond to what the needs of this community are. and that perhaps we had something that was touching people in a way that we had not expected would. And so we decided to go ahead and run the risk, because it is a little bit scary, of expanding this program out and encouraging other schools to participate with us. So last year we ran the Not in Our Schools program, and the high school district participated with us, which I wanted to also thank Dr. Vieira for that, because anytime that you're dealing with any these situations where suicide is the topic, you have to be very careful with how this is handled. And I just appreciate your willingness, Dr. Vieira, to commit your schools to this project that you really did not know how this would turn out, and you were willing to support us. And because of your support, now I think we've been rallying other school districts who are also willing to participate. So again, last year we had a program going on at our school. We did surveys. We found out that as a result of the program held at our school, 30% of our students, as a result of this program, reported feeling safer coming to school every single day. And so again, in the spirit of community activism, we want to expand this out. And so we initially did this with the high school district, our partners, and they participated with us when we did our Darkness to Light Memorial Service, which was held at Lancaster High School. And I think that had a big impact on the community and created some momentum. And it was a result of that that we were then invited to come here and did that performance here. And then the mayor came to our school, and in that visit, we decided to go ahead and have the Not in Our Town program, which would invite all of the schools in the city of Lancaster to participate. And so that's our Not in Our Town. You'll be getting a poster, then this is going to be all over town in the next couple of weeks. Okay, go ahead. And we are proud to say that we have all 11 schools of the Antelope Valley High School District participating. We have the four middle schools of the Lancaster School District participating, the one middle school of the Eastside School District participating. They only have one middle school. And our four schools in the Westside Union School District, our middle schools, are all participating. So this program is for secondary schools because the content is for more mature audiences. Whenever you're dealing with the topic of suicide, you have to be very careful with who is receiving that information. We did invite all of the private schools in the city of Lancaster, but they declined to participate in this program. So we have formed a committee of people who have been working tirelessly on this project. People were willing to step up, put a lot of time and effort in, and if not for the work of all of these people, this program would not be well underway. In particular, Dennis Greer, we call him Mr. Not in Our Town, has rallied single-handedly, I don't even know the number of community supporters, because this program not only involves the 20 schools, but it involves, I think we've got around 30 business sponsors who are donating to this program. And Gina Rossell is also on the committee. Though she's running entire school districts, she still finds time for this project and is working very hard on that. And then we have Nick Finks, our student representative, who is on the committee as well. By the way, you ought to keep an eye on this young man, because he is on his way to doing great things. I don't know if this committee would ever find the need to have a student representative. He would be the perfect candidate for that. But I'm going to go ahead and turn the rest of the presentation over to him, and he'll explain what we've been have going on and a little bit more about what to expect with the program that we've established. So, Nick Finks.
Good morning. The mission statement of the Not in Our Town program is that it facilitates partnerships between Antelope Valley businesses and Antelope Valley schools to create on-campus programs to eliminate bullying. Some components of our program for the next few months are the anti-bullying training that Westside Union School District has sponsored for all 20 participating schools. The 20 participating schools are being sponsored by community businesses all over. Schools are going to participate in the October 26th Anti-Bullying City Council Proclamation Meeting, I believe held here. Schools will also hold a anti-bullying campaign week, the week of November 15th. And there will be a Darkness to Light memorial service at the Lancaster Performing Arts Center on November 18th. I believe there are little flyers at your desk. Last night, we held an in-service for all 20 participating schools. And in fact, all 20 participating schools came, which was amazing because usually you don't see stuff like that. Team leads from each of the schools come together for the Not in Our Town force. They're consisted of principals, vice principals, counselors, teachers, and psychologists. They made one of the greatest teams, or the only greatest team that this valley has ever seen. There were about 30 student representatives there last night, and student representatives are children chosen for their ability to rally kids up for different movements and mobilize their peers into action. Last night we studied the problem of bullying and looked at the data and discussed it, and we saw how it pertained to our own campuses, and we saw what it looked like. The student representatives reflected and responded to questions prompted by Mrs. Massari. A question that was one of them asked was, how is bullying a form of, discrimination, I'm sorry. How is bullying a form of discrimination? And schools were given ideas and information about how to instill anti-bullying programs on their own campuses. This next slide is going to be a video of the 20 schools that are participating and the community sponsors and donors that have given their money to this amazing organization. Now, you may be asking yourself, how can I help? Well, I'm here to tell you. You can find out the schools and the school districts that are instilling anti-bullying programs and learn about them, know what's happening there, help as much as you can if they need help. But other than that, just be an expert on it. Also, you can know the different schools and school districts that are not instilling anti-bullying programs and help educate them of their importance, because bullying can lead to serious things. You can also be part of the community pledge held here on October 26th for anti-bullying. Please, we invite you to attend the LPAC performance on November 18th. It will be a darkness to light ceremony. If you have not seen it, it's very, very powerful. Like I said, there are flyers at your table. Also, you could individually sponsor this program. Sponsorships start at $500. We already have a sponsor that has committed $10,000. Oh, I'm sorry. This slide is going to be a video summary of the last year's DelSER True Leaders. What we're doing today is an extension of what they did, and it started this entire anti-bullying explosion.
We wish upon
Thank you for your time.
Well, thank you, Nick and Gina and Lori, for taking your time out today to make this presentation, and specifically for all the students that you do impact and are continuing to impact positively throughout the city and the valley as well, and really taking it to the next level by incorporating, you know, the businesses and so on in the city. So great job. And Commissioner Greer, for your support and involvement with this as well. Thank you.
My pleasure.
Question?
Sure.
Yeah, I think it's a absolutely wonderful program, and I think it's great that you have the participation of 20 schools. I'm curious, however, as to why there is no participation of the private schools. I don't know who could address that.
Certainly, I can't speak for them. They were invited. They received actually numerous phone calls. I don't know if they don't perceive there's a problem, or they have their own programs that they're operating. And I don't know, Lori, if you know more specifically than that. I wouldn't want to speak for them. I don't know.
Okay, so they didn't offer you any reasons why they didn't?
A few offered reasons why they didn't want to participate. I think, you know, the problem of bullying, we're all at different levels of understanding what's going on with this. I think in the private schools, many of them see their schools as the antidote to the problem, and that and maybe that's how they market themselves too. One of the schools said that they didn't have any bullying going on their campuses. But if you know anything about bullying, you know that it's gone into a covert place. It happens in cyberspace. It happens in terms of relational aggression between people who you would not suspect would bully one another, like some of the more popular kids on campus, the homecoming queens, the star basketball players, the relational things that go on between people now. It's not your typical what we think of as the schoolyard bully that's out there slamming kids around on the playground. That still exists, but that's a very manageable problem because we can see it. So it's going on so covertly, and we ourselves are just learning so much about it. We have to. And I don't, you know, so we invited 11 of them. Your city invited. They were you know, sent a letter from the mayor's office why they chose not to come, you know, other than my feeling is that they don't feel perhaps that they have a problem going on their campuses. All of us have a problem going on our campuses. And I think it's just a matter of educating people and helping them to realize that what they may not see happening, there's a whole layer of behavior going on underneath all of that. So, but other than that, you'd have to ask them.
Thank you.
You mentioned cyberbullying, and I know that's a huge issue currently. How are those situations addressed? I mean, I wouldn't imagine it's a school that it would address that, but is there another avenue as to where cyberbullying is?
We have to address it if it comes to our attention. We treat it as if it happened on our campus because that's our student to the best of our ability. We can't control it because once something gets out there into cyberspace, it may be deleted on this one phone, but it's out there. So we try, when somebody makes us aware of it, we try as best as we can to investigate the problem. Oftentimes, we'll take a look into the cell phone ourselves. We will go on to Facebook or MySpace to see what's on there. We encourage kids to print that off and bring it in to us whenever we can. We have a problem with kids forwarding text messages, and we're teaching our students now that if you receive something that's inappropriate about a student and you forward it, then now you become part of the problem. It's just a lot of educating the kids with it, which is what we do, because at Del Sur, this program is it's an instructional thing that takes place in the classroom. We spend a lot of time just teaching the kids. So they're just so unaware
And oftentimes, just because developmentally of where they are at, developmentally, they tend to be very self-centered, and not, and empathy is not an earmark trait for them. So teaching them empathy, getting them to see the devastation that others feel, you know, and it doesn't come natural to kids this age. And then if you look at our culture and what our culture finds funny and entertaining, I mean, take the show American Idol. That's one of our favorite shows, and it's a very sarcastic, and we find humor in putting people down, and yet, you know, people on that show are very outspoken about bullying. Well, you know, what are we laughing at as a society and as a community? And our kids are just, you know, that's the input that they get from the media. So, but cyberbullying, yeah, we handle it as much as we possibly can. We try to include the parents and try to just teach the kids that when you receive something, it can't be forwarded on to another student.
And you talk about the kind of the new covert way of bullying. You know, I think back to my school days, and it was the kid who stole your lunch money and, you know, was beating people up, and you were afraid to be around that kid. But are there ways that you identify maybe some of the kids who are more high risk for being the bullies? I mean, I think there's still a way to see that there are some kids who are outright bullies. And are there special services or more intense programs for them, or is it the whole school?
At our school, we know exactly who they are because we are out there. And because of what we've done so far with creating an army of student ambassadors, they know who they are, so they'll report a bully sighting. And oftentimes they can handle it themselves, but we know exactly who those kids are, and we keep an eye on them at all times. We have a system for trying to rehabilitate them, and we work very hard with their parents. We've had a great deal of support from the parents. We have had not one problem from a parent. In fact, I received a phone call last night. This is a first. A woman called to report her own daughter to me as being a bully. And she said, I do not want my daughter to be the reason why one of these other kids will take their life. So the people, the parents appreciate the fact that we are trying to make our campus a safer place, and we're doing everything we can to rehabilitate our kids who have fallen into this behavior. And what we're trying to do is change the culture on our campus, because it needs to become totally, disgustingly unaccepted by all the kids. They need to look at it and say, you know, that's not cool here. And so I think very slowly we are actually getting to that point.
Great. Well, you're doing a great job.
Thanks.
Lori, I just had one question. In the presentation Nick talked about, or it was on display as well, anti-bullying training. What's involved in that?
Well, it can be many different things, but last night what we did is I had all of the 20 participating schools, the team leads. Each principal designated a team lead who would actually run the anti-bullying campaign for the week of November 15th on their campus, and then one student representative, because at each school there will be 10 student ambassadors who will also run the program. So we just went over a lot of the bullying statistics that we've learned. I shared with them the strategies of what we've done on our campus, gave them additional ideas for what they could do on their campuses, explained to them just the program in general, and had an interactive session really with the students that were involved there, wanting to put this on their shoulders. This really needs to be a student-centered program, otherwise it does not work. If it doesn't come from the kids, if it's not happening with the kids, it's never going to go anywhere. So we just spent a lot of time last night talking about the issue, the data, listening to the kids and their perceptions, and sharing with us what was going on each of their campuses that they see. I asked them some questions and tried to get them to think a little bit and start the discussion there, and just give everybody some of the information that we've learned about the seriousness of the problem, because even educators don't really know. So I think it was a productive thing, and it got the whole team motivated to get started on their programs for November. So now the committee and all of you and the city council will be invited to visit these schools, and they'll be sending me their schedules of activities and all of that. So it would be really great if some of you are interested in attending, and we will definitely invite you to do that. And that holds the schools accountable also if they know that you will be there.
What if you could do a poll of the students, of an election, if you will, every month or two, in which they vote on the biggest bullies in school, and you publish that list of the top five bullies every month? You could send home bumper stickers. My son was the bully of the month. But I think kids this age are very responsive to peer pressure.
You know what? I feel like doing that when I get a bully. I like to throw him out on the playground and strap him up to the, basketball court out there. I don't know. That's something that we could probably discuss. It's not part of our protocol now for handling this situation, but.
At the beginning of your presentation, you'd mentioned the positive experience you had at Del Sur School this past year, and I'm curious how that evaluation was done, if there was anything that was quantifiable that came out of it.
We took a survey of the kids, asking them many questions. One of them is, do you feel safe coming to school every day? Only 64% of our kids said that they felt safe coming to school every day, which I thought, I was surprised, because I see our campus as a very safe and peaceful place.
And that was before the program started, I'm assuming. Yeah.
And then after the program ended, we did the same survey to find that like 92% of our kids feel safe coming to school every day. So, and now we're doing, we continue to survey them on different topics. This year we're focusing on how do you perceive staff members in their response to bullying, and they graded us. And so that's sort of how we're looking at that, so.
And you're going to have the same types of evaluations through the 20 schools that are participating this year as well?
I offered that as part of suggestion of what they should do. Mm-hmm. I gave them a packet of materials from which they could choose, and hopefully that they would do that, because that would be a good, indicator of the effectiveness of their programs. Mm-hmm. So.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Well, again, thank you very much for your time. You're welcome to stay, but if you need to get back, we understand as well. So, thank you. Public business from the floor, agendized, any cards, Brett? No? Okay. Consent calendar, approval of the minutes of September 8, 2010. Board or commissioners, did you get a chance to take a look at those? Mm-hmm. Okay. I have a motion.
Move to accept the minutes.
Second.
Okay, we have the voting there. I'll go ahead and vote. Unanimous, thank you. Commission staff presentations, updates, and reports. We'll start out with the monthly crime statistics. Jim Cobalt.
Thank you, Chairman. If I can bring this up on the screen here. Okay, this report covers September 5th through October 9th, 2010. Essentially, that's weeks 37 through 41 of the calendar year of 2010. This table, as every month, displays our level of activity for Part 1 crimes and arrests and reports, numbers issued. Probably the most active week for Part 1 crimes was the September 12th through the 18th, week 38. And then you can see a decline for the two successive weeks, and week 41 up there contains incomplete data yet, so that's essentially where that is. It's also important to understand that these data are for those events that were able to be geocoded, but this is a pretty average range for us. It's a range that that we want to be in right now. These This 56 to 73 range is not too bad. Violent, or for the arrests down here, you can see the most active week for arrests was week 37. This information is accumulated off of the booking slips from the station, and so this represents what we were able to aggregate from the booking slips. And then for the unique unique report numbers that were issued, you can see that week 38 was the most active for that. As we look at the most active reporting districts, we can start with 1127. 1127 is the area that goes essentially from 20th Street West out to 60th Street West, I to K. And you can, as you take a look at that, you can see the Part 1 activity that occurred there. A lot of the Part 1 activity, just one second. Got to help our technician out. Just one second. Okay, a lot of the Part 1 activity is centralized up in the area between 30th and 20th around Avenue J. Again, that's the Valley Central Way area, and you can take a look at that and see that accepts a lot of the responsibility for what goes on at 1127. The next area is 1126, and that had 26 Part 1 crimes that could be geocoded. And let's go to that. As we take a look at 1126, it goes essentially from Avenue J down to the South City limits from 20th to 10th Street West. And a lot of our activity is in the area that is around Avenue K, within a 1 mile section north and south of there. You can see a lot of the activity up here along 20th Street West. We also continue to have the issue down here with the apartment complex that is just south of Avenue K and west of the freeway. Then 1121, one that we're pretty familiar with by now, had 25 incidents. That 1121 is just pretty dispersed around the entire area. You can see a lot of larcenies, and one of the things that has been interesting about 1121 is you'll notice in here some of these arsons that are occurring. This is not the first month that these arsons have been occurring in 1121, and I'm not exactly sure what the common point is on it, but it's an interesting observation at this point. We also have some vehicle thefts and some assaults or aggravated assaults that have occurred in these this area. The next area is 1122, which had 17 geocoded Part 1 crimes. Now, 1122 is from Sierra Highway to 10th Street West, Avenue I to Avenue J, and essentially that kind of comprises a lot of our downtown area. And you can see what's happening in that area. We've got some burglaries up on the northern part of it. We also have a series of larcenies down along the western side and along Sierra Highway as well. And then there are two reporting districts for that are fall into fifth place. That's 1124 and 1133, both with 16. (clears throat) 1124 is essentially K to M, 10th Street West to the east limit. And as you can see, this area up here, K, This is a series of apartments up off of Gadsden, south of Avenue K, and of course, you can see the concentration of activities around these apartment complexes up here. And then everything else seems to migrate east of Sierra Highway, particularly up in the area around Avenue K, if you take a look at that area up there. And then the last area that we wanted to look at was 1133. 1133 is essentially Sierra Highway to Challenger Way, J to K, and it's basically the area north of where we just looked at. You can see what's going on up there as well. A lot of the activity around this area centers a lot more around the primary roadways rather than into the residential areas, at least during this reporting period.
Jim, excuse me, Jim, mm-hmm. The last slide that had a lot of activity up around Avenue K on the east side, mm-hmm. Is that because it's along Avenue K, it's predominantly commercial businesses up in there? Is that what most of that stuff's related to?
This area in 1124?
Yes.
These apartments along Gadsden have historically been.
I'm sorry, it would have been the next map after that K, and I want to say out by Challenger, it looked like maybe.
Right over here?
Yeah. K and then J also on that same map.
Yeah. These are primarily because of, this is a vehicle theft. I think that vehicle theft may have been in a mobile home park, but I'm not sure. I'd have to look at the data for it. And then we have some larcenies down here on the south side of the street. You can see we have a burglary. Now, when you split up, you may have a concentration of crime, but when you have a reporting district boundary running between them, sometimes that doesn't appear as a clear pattern because one piece of that crime series gets reported in one reporting district and the other one gets reported in the other reporting district. So it really takes a visual layout like this to be able to pick up on that.
I will tell you, though, that there's a lot of density there as far as our commercial businesses in those areas, especially along both sides of the street on Avenue K, out in that area there. So there's probably some correlation there to gravitation of the crime there.
This essentially looks at the frequency of residence burglaries during the reporting period. 1132 led the way with 6 residential burglaries, and then 1121, 22, 23, and 92 had 5 residential burglaries. 1126, 27, 33, and 35 had 4 residential burglaries. And then 1124, 1136, and 1137 had 3 residential burglaries. Now we start moving into the larcenies involving vehicles. And again, this is kind of an interesting area for us to look at because larcenies, when we really go after trying to bring down our crime rate, offer us a real opportunity to do that if we can look at the data and understand what it says. Particularly with regard to this, we take a look at the reporting districts and the frequencies. 1137. Now these are thefts involving vehicles. It could be property taken from the interior of a vehicle, from the exterior of a vehicle. But what we did was we take a look at that and kind of put those in that category to just see if we can identify any patterns in it. This looks at the frequencies by reporting district. 1137 had 6, 1134 had 3, and then 1123, 26, 27, 35, and 92 had 3 of these type of larcenies. Now, when we look at them and we break them down, we start looking at what kind of vehicle are they attacking. And when we take a look at that, we can see that the Honda make is the most commonly attacked during this reporting period, followed by just an unknown because the person who took the report did not fill in what type of vehicle it was, so that doesn't give us much to go on. Followed by Dodges, Chevrolets, Fords, and then you get down into almost the one-time occurrence. Now, There was some, a couple of interesting things in this. We looked at 34 events in this particular incident. Now, this is where we can really start to have some impact if we begin to think about it. If you take a look at that top one up there, they entered through the door and the door was unlocked. And then right below that, you see unknown and unknown. And essentially what that means is that the person who went out and took the report, the person who's making the report couldn't remember whether or not they locked the car, but the person taking the report could find no signs of forced entry. So we kind of look at those through the same lens, if you will. And then you scroll on down again to the very bottom down there, and there is a door, but the means of entry is unknown because, again, there was no signs of forced entry. Essentially, what we look at here is about 56% of these 34 were cases where somebody had to do was walk by, open up a car door, get inside, take what they wanted, and then leave. These are some things that I mean, you can take a look over here. We don't see a lot of sophistication in the other crimes over here. You have where somebody shattered a rear window. That was a one-time occurrence during the five-week reporting period. The right front window was shattered. We're not seeing the biggest collection of events or circumstances that are set up where people are not securing their own property. So certainly that has to be an area of attention for us. The other thing that we're seeing too, particularly over on the east side in about the 1700 block of Avenue J, there were a series of thefts over there where people went off and left their purse or their wallet inside the car to go inside and pay for gasoline. And when they came back out to their vehicle, their possessions were gone. And so we had about three to maybe four occurrences of that. That really kind of stood out as you looked at the data. And from what I could tell, there wasn't a good description of any real suspects. There were some people seen in the area and those kinds of things, but there wasn't much to go on with regard to that. When we start looking at property taken in these vehicle larcenies, the number one thing this time was a driver's license, and that was primarily because that was either in a wallet or a purse that was taken. So the object of attack here in all likelihood wasn't really driver's licenses. It was probably the wallet or a purse that was actually in it. Then we followed by credit cards, social security cards, cash. Small electronics played a role as well. We still see a little bit of radios and stereos coming out of them. And then everything else kind of breaks down into the smaller or the smaller frequencies of two or one. When we take a look at these, at the places where these types of crimes occurred, we saw a little bit of an elevation this week in the public parking lot. That went up to 12, followed by residential driveways and apartment lots as number 6. So, again, as we take a look at this, you can see merely parking your car in your driveway and leaving it unlocked doesn't protect you from much. So, you know, one of the things that we want to think about is we know where it's happening. We know it's happening in the driveways. We know it's happening in the public parking lots, and we know that it's happening in the apartment lots. So these are all areas that we can think about as we formulate how we want to respond. Now, when we look at our grand theft vehicles, and essentially the two main stat codes that I looked at for this were 91 and 93, which were basically the actual theft of a car or the actual theft of a truck. In the residential driveways, we saw as the most frequent place where a vehicle is stolen from, followed by a residential street, an apartment lot, and public parking lots, and then it breaks on down into the single, single events or single areas. As far as keys and vehicle, 18 of the events said no, or that they were not there. Four of them said yes, the keys were in it. And frequently where the key was in it, it was, rather than being a real hardcore stolen auto, it tended to be like a girlfriend-boyfriend situation where somebody had a key or something like that, or the owner gave somebody a key to go out and listen to the music in the car and they took off with it or something like that. Or they picked up somebody that they really didn't know and they walked off and left the car running with the air conditioning running while they went into Walmart. And then two where it was just unknown. They didn't know whether the keys were in it or not. When we look at the vehicles that were most commonly stolen, Honda still leads the list with that, followed by Ford, Saturn, Nissan, Lexus, and Chevrolet, and then the single event makes. When we look at those recovered, 15 of these 23 were recovered, 8 were not. A lot of the 15 were, again, those situations where somebody knew somebody or the suspect was an acquaintance somehow or another of the victim. And the 8 that were stolen, I didn't see any indication that the suspect knew anybody in those 8 or that the victim knew the suspect. When we look at where the vehicles were recovered, of the ones recovered, we got Lancaster, or 10 were recovered in Lancaster. One was recovered by the California Highway Patrol, but it didn't say in there exactly where it was recovered. One was recovered by LAPD down in LA. I think it was the 77th station or 77th Street station. One in Inglewood, and one where the it was an outside agency, and it was unknown where it was recovered. That pretty much takes care of the data that came from that. If you take a look at your maps that I provided you, the first map that you would probably want to look at is the one that has the crime classifications in the right legend. You can see where those are or where the actual crimes lay out at within the city. And then also, if you'll notice in the legend in the lower left, you can see the density by reporting district, and that gives you the range, if you will, of the Part 1 crimes that occurred in each one of those reporting districts. Obviously, the red is more active, followed by the orange, yellow. Light green is good. Dark green is very good because that means nothing happened there. Excuse me. The next map on the right legend has the spatial trend analysis, and essentially what that does is it compares this reporting period that we're looking at to the previous reporting period that I reported to you on during your last meeting. This shows where the more active areas are in the darker red and where the areas that we've made progress in the light and dark green. You can kind of see how it lays out across the city on where things are trending up and where things are trending down. The last map in front of you, if you take a look, is the Part 1 crime event, and it's our October 2010 forecast. We introduced this visual method of displaying our forecast to you at the last Criminal Justice Commission meeting. And one of the things that I did was I went back at the end of September and I created a density map showing what September looked like, and we were spot on with it with the exception of 1131 and 1125, which we actually overestimated just a little bit. And everything else laid out exactly as we forecasted it would. This is our forecast for October of 2010. And I'd ask if there are any questions.
Thank you.
kind of a question. I just have a comment. It, with the grand theft automobiles, I mean, it seems alarming that the majority of those were out of the driveway of a residence. You know, I just would have guessed it would have been a parking lot at a business somewhere, but, you know, residential driveway. So for the average guy who's not putting his car in the garage, he's leaving it in a place that's got the highest likelihood of having a problem. And it seemed like the larcenies out of the car are the same kind of thing. So, you know, if you're not in the garage, you're running higher odds. And if you've got it in the driveway, it needs to be locked. And I would assume, you know, purses, wallets, those things. When I looked at the list of the items taken, almost all is credit card, driver's license, Social Security. All those things I would anticipate are probably in somebody's wallet or in their purse. So, you know, five or six down was wallet and purse, but all the things above that I would assume are probably items that are typically in somebody's wallet or purse. So if you've got something like that that's drawing their attention to the vehicle and it's unlocked, you're really just begging for trouble. And even locked, it shouldn't be in plain view, I guess, is the takeaway from all that.
Well, I think one of the things that's important is that's one reason why you really have to look at your data and you have to break it down. And then you've got to be able to know what your data not only tells you, but how do you change the way that you approach that situation to actually be able to respond to it and get folks to work with you. Again, though, the problem is sometimes people get in a hurry and they get out of the car and they think they lock their car, you know, especially in one of the things that you commonly see in those unknown reports is somebody thought they hit their button on their car key. You know, as they were walking away, they thought they hit their button, but they weren't sure. And of course, that therein lies the rub.
I think the thing is for us is it's something we emphasize through our Neighborhood Watch program. We also emphasize it on our public safety website here at the city. It's something that we need to promote more and to notify people out in the community that this is what we're running into as far as thefts from vehicles. And the other side of it is most of those auto thefts out of the driveway are occurring during nighttime hours. Things we talk about people in Neighborhood Watch as far as lighting, okay, motion detectors, things like that that set that lighting off. Myself, I had a vehicle that was stolen right out of my driveway at one time, okay, and punched ignition. The bottom line is that they're very serious about taking it, and they took it. The reality is I didn't have any of the things that I preach about all the time at my own house, so I set that up. So a lot of times we're good at getting the information out and don't do it and practice it ourselves. So that's the thing we need to emphasize out there. You know, ever since I did install those things, I haven't had another incident at my house. So it does work, and it is. I like the motion sensor thing because the people think someone flipped the light on, you know, for a duration of time rather than just have the lighting on all the time. And out of the residential area, because depending on how a street's set up, you know, the accessibility might be good, and we want to eliminate people from being able to conceal themselves on your property to have access to your things. The other part is opportunity crime with larcenies out of vehicles. That's something that's been historical. I believe there's a certain amount based on how good a job the Sheriff's Department and all the other law enforcement agencies have done with lowering the crime rate. We get into a state of mind of complacency, okay? And, I mean, we talk about this all the time. All of us that have been here forever, we went to Antelope Valley High School and took my keys out of ignition and threw under the seat of my car and went to school. Okay, it wasn't an issue, and our parents left our houses unlocked. That's just not the way things are. And we'd have to retrain the public to understand that. And it's not being in a sense of mind of paranoia. It's just being aware, okay, being aware of your surroundings, who's in the area, how to identify that, and who to report that to. So that's something we're constantly dealing with. As far as educating the public on these issues, and so we can address them.
I think part of the challenge, too, though, is the messaging, reaching out to everyone, because not everyone reads the newspaper, not everyone goes on the website. So what will be the challenge will be how to outreach to the community as a whole.
Well, ultimately, the whole point is through the Neighborhood Watch. You know, we want to have a Neighborhood Watch program in every neighborhood, and then we want to take folks out there and have them take ownership of the issues that relate directly into their community. And that's part of it. You know, we just had one last night. Megan, they've been, that program's growing. you know, the tendency is what can the city do for me? And it's really not the case. Is what? How do you take ownership of your community? And we're going to give you the information on how to empower your neighbors to keep an eye on the things that you have there and deal with those issues. And it's really your job to do that, okay? Our job is to come in there, and we have certain responsibilities as a community leaders and law enforcement and the city. At the same time, we can't be everywhere. And so it's more as we grow that program and get that ownership taken, the stronger we're going to be in that. And hopefully through that, we're going to be able to reach those folks that don't read the newspaper or don't have access to the websites or those kind of things and get that community outreach out there.
I do think the Neighborhood Watch is really the key to that outreach. And I'd love to see that grow more and maybe talk to you about myself getting further involved in working with those and some ideas
I might welcome
have.
It.
Okay, great.
We're busy.
Okay.
You know, if I might add one thing to that, if you talk to our investigators over at the station, you know, the good news is we do not have a gang of professional car thieves operating in Lancaster. When you see what happens to these cars, you saw the numbers that are recovered right here in Lancaster. They appear to just be taken for short joyrides, like, you know, some kid, you know, crime of opportunity sees that the car's available, it's dark, nobody's around, let's grab this baby, and they take it over the other side of town to do whatever they're going to do. They abandon it. They're not selling the parts. They're not stripping the cars. They're just abandoned after they've driven around for a short period of time. So that's good news in that that type of car theft is easily preventable. Much easier than if you've got a group of pros operating in town that are going to hit you and take them out of town somewhere and strip them or something like that. So, yeah, the key is help educate the public so they don't leave their cars in vulnerable positions.
Well, to follow up on Lee's comments and yours, you know, my comments about in the driveway were not to say that the Sheriff's Department's job should be to go around and tell people to you know, go out and lock the car at night. You know, like Lee said, everybody has to own this problem as individual citizens. If they don't want to make the extra effort to be sure that the car is locked, then clearly by the numbers we saw, the odds go up that you know you're going to be somebody that's a victim potentially because you're more convenient than the guy who's locked his car door. If the highest number of those were involving vehicles by a large margin that were unlocked, it suggests to me that the guy who's stealing the car is not going to take on the most difficult challenge, and not if there's one three doors down that's unlocked. And you know, obviously the sheriff can't go around and police people's cars in their driveway. That's up to the individual to do.
You know, I can tell you that the same thing happened to me, it was actually to my daughter, and it was on the street. And the reason is because her car was on the street, because my car was inside the garage and our other daughter's car was in the garage. So, you know, we have all these cars. So hers was in the street, but she didn't lock it. And so then they took her DVD player, and so right then was when we realized that we just didn't think it would happen to us. So then we took precautionary measures, and then we began installing bars, you know, on our patio door, and then we put the floodlights in and that kind of thing, because we hadn't done it before because we felt safe. So, you know.
Comments, questions further? No? Captain Hoos, California Highway Patrol update.
Things are going well. Not with the budget, but with the Highway Patrol. In the Antelope Valley, we've actually had a trend that's continuing our fatalities that normally, in fact, this time last year, we were at 23 fatalities at this point, and normally we end the year with 29 or 30, somewhere in that area. Well, we currently have 9, so it's extremely low. I'd love to take credit for that and reduce vehicle theft and reduce collisions, but might have something to do with improved technology also, but I'll take credit for it anyway. The DUI-related collisions, we had 14 in September, which is commensurate, pretty standard for us. Our DUI arrests, we stay right around 15. It was pretty normal last month. One thing we're still experiencing is the officers, given the economy and everything that's going on, not just in Lancaster and Palmdale, but throughout the Antelope Valley and throughout the United States, with the economy the way it is, the officers are writing significantly more fix-it tickets. The fix-it tickets that are on a, what's called a 281, which is an internal document that they people actually have signed off at our office, and the regular citation, which is a fix-it ticket. Our numbers actually are up, to give you an idea, our 281, which is the internal document that they bring to us and show that they had it fixed. Last year we were at 333, and this year we're at 932 as far as the issuance. And the citations that the officers are writing that are purely for a fix-it ticket, a taillight, a headlight, a cracked windshield, those kind of things, last year we were at 767, and this year we're at 1,124. And the officers are doing that because they're aware of it. I mean, our goal, the end result, is saving lives and ensuring people's safety. It's not revenue generation, contrary to some things we've been instructed on occasion, but it's not. And so if we can correct people's behavior just by a citation that is almost free of cost, that's helpful. Now, certainly the fix-it tickets the officers are writing, the Highway Patrol doesn't charge for any of the services at our counter, signing off tickets, releasing vehicles, those kind of things. So we get quite a bit of traffic there. And there is a small fee from the court for some of the fix-it tickets, but that particular fee is, I think some of those are just a deterrent, so people fix it without the Highway Patrol having to remind them to do so. So it's worthwhile. We're still, of course, encouraging seatbelt use, and there is a big move on distracted driving. And while the majority of individuals are focused on texting and emailing and such, it's really distracted driving in general. Our statistics statewide don't actually support that texting itself or emailing itself is causing collisions. And I know you see that contrary to, that's contrary to what you're saying on television, but our experience has been any kind of distracted driving, makeup, shaving, combing their hair, reading the newspaper, all these things, that any kind of distraction actually delays your response and is causing collisions. But when we're looking at the statistics throughout the state, it's nice, and it's been a really good public response towards texting and driving and email and driving and such, but any kind of distraction is significant.
When you look at those distracted driving incidents, can you correlate that with a certain age group?
We don't. We have, but the numbers are so they're not statistically significant. Even when you look at statewide statistics, at this point, because we just enacted some of these laws, there's not enough gathered for us to say, you know, the majority of those violators are this age. Mm-hmm. The majority of our violators currently are commuters, and so it's our workforce. The citations that we're issuing, and we had a distracted driving day on, I believe it was the 5th, on the 5th of October, and we have another one on the 26th of October in the Antelope Valley, in fact, in all of LA County. We're specifically targeting distracted driving, which if you happen to be eating a McDonald's cheeseburger, which I enjoy, and you're driving, there's a possibility you'll get a citation. It's not illegal per se, but what happens is when you are distracted and you, many times you're coming outside of your lane or following too close or you're not really attentive to your driving. So you want to keep an eye out for us on the 26th. We did, unfortunately, have a fatality on Saturday. I wasn't looking right at you, Lee. It's okay. It's okay. It was the cheeseburger. On Saturday, we had a fatality, and it's a fatality that many times gets a lot of attention for two reasons. One, it involved a big rig, and two, the fatality was an infant. And so while it is... was not that unusual for us, because it draws such a significant pull, we brought out some of our higher level investigators to take a look at it. And on 26th Street West at Avenue A is a collision. A big rig was coming down, and it was traveling, it was coming down 60th Street West, approaching the intersection of A. And speed was not really a factor. The driver was coming right down his own particular lane. And husband, wife, and their infant child in the car seat between them in an F-150 was stopped at the stop sign. They physically stopped and then proceeded through the intersection, presumably thinking that the big rig was going to stop and were nowhere near anticipating it. They pulled right in front of the truck. It was a straight broadside collision at 55 miles an hour. And so the husband and the wife, the man and the woman, are both significant injury. But the child, who was in the car seat and properly strapped in, was hit so directly broadside that their internal damage, internal injuries, and also head trauma from hitting the side of the car seat, which does occur. When you have that kind of a collision, it's not – car seats are an excellent tool, but they can't stop everything. And certainly an infant is fragile. And so the infant passed away. We transported to the hospital, but it died. So,
Captain, do you see, I live out on the west side, and I know going up 60th and 70th, there's certain intersections that consistently I'll see accidents. For instance, Avenue J and 70th West, because it is a two-way stop as opposed to a four-way stop. Has there been any discussion about perhaps it could be inconvenient and maybe slow your drive time, but actually installing stop signs at those intersections that currently have two-way stops up to a certain point? I mean, that seems to be, you know, you see the skid marks all the time, and I see cars all the time pulled over, little collisions. My neighbor totaled her car at that intersection, and it sounds to me like that's the exact same situation.
It does happen, and honestly, I mean, that it's not a lot different than an uncontrolled intersection. You know, they're out in areas where there is no stop sign. But what we've done is we took a look at 3 years, 5 years, and 7 years of fatality and specifically injury collisions to determine if there are any intersections that have a real high incidence of fatalities and high incidence of high injury. And it is very sporadic. I mean, some of it is consistent with the volume of traffic that we have through an intersection. You know, some intersections will have 10 cars a day, and the other ones will have, you know, 20,000. And those are going to have a few more collisions, but not significantly more.
So it's not just collisions in general. It's injury and fatality that you're looking at.
When we're looking at it, we study fatalities very closely. And because there's normally anywhere from 30 to 50 in the Antelope Valley, although this year it's not many, we have to go back 3 to 5 years to get something that's really significant. But when you actually pin map it, it's all over the board. And it is this particular one was absolutely – in fact, if you look on it and Google Earth, this particular intersection, which I looked at this morning, wide open – no traffic. The only vehicle approaching was this truck. A big rig was coming, and they pulled out. Which, I mean, all of us have pulled out in front of things that you absolutely didn't see. And this is what occurred on this particular case. And we haven't found that there's significantly more on a partially controlled intersection versus fully controlled.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome. Sorry, long answer.
That's okay.
And that's what I had.
Any other questions? Thank you very much, Captain Hughes.
Thank you.
From our Neighborhood Impact Program, Commissioner Harris.
Okay. We just finished up our big work day, which was last Saturday, October the 2nd. We painted 22 houses in the Trend area, painted Sunnydale School. We promised them that we would at least do the front, but we were able to get all the way to the back, and there's still only one building that we didn't get to, so we will go back and finish that. In the Mariposa area, they've had a couple of barbecues there, and so they're beginning to let the residents know exactly what it is that they're doing in the area. At Desert View, they started talking to the community, began working on the two houses that Neighborhood Impact has there. In going back to the Trend area, we started the tutoring program this last week, and so we're continuing to work with Nancy Corey and with Endeavor middle school to educate the teachers, let them know. We've been to their staff meetings, and so we're just working well, I think, with the schools. They've just been so cooperative. Really appreciate that. And just letting them know, we are there to help these kids with their homework. And then at Paiute Middle School, they're now going to put in a garden. So there will be a garden at Paiute Middle School. And the whole idea with the garden is to have it at each one of the locations. So I think that it's going well so far.
I know last time you mentioned in the little farmer's market you have there in Trend. How's that coming along?
We're working on the next step right now, which is gathering 10 families that are interested in the garden, because you have to get it to the point where it is really the community garden, and then you do the farmer's market. So that's our next step.
Thank you for the work you do.
Chairman Vera, just a comment. As we're out there in the neighborhoods now, Commissioner Harris, we're hearing more and more about neighborhoods that are expressing a desire for a community home in their neighborhoods. So as we coordinate this and as you go out, I'd like to coordinate that some into our neighborhood watch zone areas. Mm-hmm. So I ideally eventually to hopefully have a home in each zone that we have set out through the city, which is, I know, a big task, but it did come up again Monday night in a group meeting that we had in a neighborhood with the mayor. And so it is something that the community is becoming well aware of that is taking place.
You know, again, along those lines, I made a note here also, Concepcion, with regards to some of the work that you're doing with the parents for the kids after school. I know that in the school districts, we do have, at times, surplus equipment that we surplus out and donate back. So we'll check, and you know, I'll check with some of the districts to see if maybe it's a possibility of some of these surplus items that would be able to be used within the work you're doing there in the community or neighborhood as well.
You know, we would appreciate that. Endeavor has already given us some textbooks, and because when the kids come in, we want to make sure that if they didn't bring their book with them, we've got something, and so that would be great. We'll take whatever it is. Going back to the neighborhood watch, I think it's a really good idea. We want to make sure that the community is involved with that, and I think I had mentioned this before. I think we're at that point where we can do that, and that is to actually go to Antelope Valley Christian School and Lee and invite the entire community there, let them know about Neighborhood Watch, see what it is that we can do, and then let them know about Neighborhood Impact as well, and have them, you know, do a question answer session. I don't know, but I think that would be a really good idea. So I'd like to do that. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thank you.
Commissioner Harris, can you expound a little bit on the 22 houses that you painted, how many people, where you got the paint, that kind of stuff for us?
The paint is paint and all the supplies are donated by the congregations of Central Christian Church and Grace Chapel. And so we worked together on that. There were five churches that were involved, so we're getting more and more churches that are volunteering to be a part of Neighborhood Impact, but we pay for that on our own. So. And there were 22 houses. I'm not quite sure what I can tell you about the families, but I'll tell you one thing that is really the reason why we do this. And one of the members of our congregation is using hospice care, and the hospice nurse happens to be in the Trend area, and we were painting her house on Saturday. And the member of our congregation said this was the sweetest lady she's ever worked with, one of the best nurses she's ever had. I know this individual, so I can't wait to go back. She's a single parent, raising a teenage son, the nicest lady. And we had asked her, you know, besides your house, what else might there be that we could do? Because she is a single parent. And she said, you know, I just needed my toilet fixed. And so we took a look at it, and it turned out it was just the handle was just wearing down. It was a simple fix. We were happy to do it. And she's going to be done, I think, with the hospice care at the end of the month, but this person from the Trend area is going to continue that relationship with the member of our congregation. And so that's the kind of thing, you know, that those relationships, because that's what it's all about. So that's just one of the stories. We had another family who, in the garden, we've got like five different types of chilies, and so we're the expert gardeners, because they haven't grown these before. They're and I don't eat chilies, and so, so anyway, we've been kind of trial and error, you know, picking them and that kind of thing, but we talked to the homeowner, and so he said he has grown chilies before, so now he's going to be starting to work in the garden. So that's the whole idea, and I said, you know, you're now the chili expert, you know, of the Tran Garden, and so, you know, you're going to tell us when to pick these and what color they need to be, and, you know, so it's relationships. That's what it's all about.
How many people does it take to paint 22 houses?
With between that and the school, it was between 450 and 500 people.
It's a good community effort about them coming together, isn't it?
So, yeah.
Yes. And thank you for organizing all that.
You're welcome. I think the next big effort that we're going to have is that we've already started working with Elizabeth Brubaker talking about the what we're going to be doing on the Martin Luther King Work Day. And so that will be the cleanup effort. I think we've designated Mariposa area and also Parkview to try to see what we can do to clean up there. So we love doing it and love the partnership with the city.
Commissioner Vieira, I'm sorry. Commissioner Harris, one recommendation I have is I noticed that Chairman Vieira had asked about the Paiute gardening effort over there and eventually evolving that into a farmer's market. I could just recommend to you maybe contacting, there's a local family here that's been involved in the agribusiness for a lifetime, and I know they have a very keen interest in revitalizing the Paiute area, and that's John Calandry Farms, and you could probably find his expertise invaluable.
Okay.
And he's very active in the community. I think he'd be a good contact for you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Moving on, Business Watch Subcommittee, and if Lee, if we just want to tie in 5 and 6 together with the updates, that'd be great.
Okay, I can do that. The number 5 is really easy. We've had 3 meetings scheduled, and we've had 3 cancellations. One of them being ours, 2 of them being theirs. So what I'd like to do by email, if I could get your calendars for the next couple weeks, and I'm going to give it to them and say, pick a time, okay? And then we're going to live by that time. It's been some unforeseen issues that have come up. At this point, if we can't get something with them, particularly in the next couple weeks, I think we move on, because I have contacted a couple other of the larger retail stores who are ready for us to come and speak to them. So this one became a hot topic because of some issues that's directly related to it, which I just want to comment for once. 1135 was not in the top 5 for once, and that's due to some real hard work by the Sheriff's Department, the other agencies, law enforcement agencies locally have been doing some operational stuff in that area, so it has had an impact. Again, though, we still need to address some issues.
Are you perceiving any avoidance on the part of the... Okay.
Absolutely none. I'm seeing that it has purely been a scheduling issue to get the parties that we want there. Mr. Bozegan has talked to them about who we'd like to be at that meeting, okay, and it's some regional folks there as well as their crime prevention people, which I think is a good thing based on the fact that they have such a significant presence here in the community, and so that's been the issue. So that was what I talked about with their representative the other day. If I could get, as yesterday we had this conversation, that if I could get your calendars and then for the next 2 weeks, and then they will work their calendar to match whatever day will work for us.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Next, Marlene, could you please stand up? This is our newest member of our public safety team here at the City of Lancaster, Marlene Navarro. Marlene is a community services officer for how long now?
2.5 years.
2.5 years. So she's been working the field over there at the station on PM shift. I brought her over here because she's a super qualified for the things that we're doing. She has her personality, and she's bilingual, and I've already given her some pretty difficult things to deal with. She's going to be tackling our restitution collection and management of all those vandalism cases as they come here, and some other issues related to accidents and things where the city becomes a victim and needs to be recompensated by the offending party. She's also actively jumped right into with some of our neighborhood programs and is learning that, and some of our community partnerships, and we're kind of all over the place with Megan and Marlene and all the things they're doing.
Jim, could you talk a little bit about how you're kicking off your community youth court right now to the commission, just what
Sure.
you're at with it right now?
Essentially what we're doing is, a couple of years ago we got a charge from the city council to come up with a community service program for youthful offenders. One of the things we did was we set out to try to find out how effective just the standalone community service program was. We called up and down the state, and essentially what we were seeing was a lot of those programs were running somewhere in a 60% to 70% recidivism rates, and we know if we do nothing, at least in studies that have been done on California youth, if we do nothing, the recidivism rate is around 30%. So it seemed to be some of those programs might have been driving the numbers just a little bit. So we decided to look around the country to see exactly what what was working and what wasn't. And we elected to follow a diversion program model that's called a community youth court. And that's being done all across the country. It's not the same thing as the teen court that's run by juvenile probation. This is simply a diversion program to try to keep them out of that system. And what we did was we kind of modeled it after the program down in Santa Clarita. They have it set up kind of the way we do. They've got a teen court, but they also have this diversionary program that they call community youth court that they work with the sheriff's department on. And the sheriff's department looks at minor offenses, and they check the youth in their systems to make sure that they're first-time offenders. And if they qualify, they send the cases over to us. And what we do is the cases are assigned to actually our intern from, if you would, Tammy, stand up just for a second. This is Tammy Dietrich. Tammy is our intern from the Masters of Social Work program out at CSU Bakersfield. And essentially what Tammy does is she contacts the parents of the youth and says, you know, would you like to have your youth participate in this program? Now, we only take youth who are accepting responsibility for their actions. If they want to debate it, they want to argue, or they want to do window shopping about which is cheaper, we send it back over to the sheriff's department. But if the youth is truly interested in trying to mend the fence and correct what they did wrong, then those are the youth that we bring into the program. And they come in, and we have a jury of their peers. We actually hold the court right here in council chambers. We usually have a judge that's either a juvenile court judge or one of the DAs from downtown. They come in and hear the case, and jury, the teen jury, gets a chance to hear it, and then they make recommendations to us within certain guidelines about what they can do and what they can't do. One of the things we'd like to encourage anybody that's associated with kids right now is if you know of some youth, particularly the high school youth, and Chairman Vieira and I have talked about this, we'd like to get kids that are interested in being involved as jurors into the program so that they can come in and actually present their cases in front of their peers. The traffic cases, we tend to put those just in front of a judge, but if we have a truancy or a petty theft or something like that, then we end up putting that in front of the jury. We're too young right now and too new. We don't even have anybody who's completed the process yet, so we don't know. We haven't been able to calculate how successful we are. One of the things we did do, though, and we went down and met with Judge Wesley on this one down in Los Angeles, and one of the things that we talked to him about is how do you evaluate your program, and he goes, I wish I'd have thought of that at the outset. And we built that into the program. We have a professor from CSU Bakersfield that'll look at the numbers, calculate them for us, and let us know what we're doing right and what we're doing wrong and how to try to address that. So that's pretty much in a nutshell what we're doing right now.
Jim, do these proceedings, do they take place during school time, afternoons, evenings?
Afternoons. Usually it's on the first and third Wednesday. We try to get them here. We try to bring the parents and the juvenile in about 3:30. We indoctrinate them into what's expected of them today, and what to do when they come up to the podium and speak to the judge, and the decorum that's required and everything else. We've got a dress code, and if they blow it, they go home, and those kinds of things. And really what we've seen is that there's a couple of students that we've been tracking real closely because they had some rather profound problems. And what's impressive is of those kids that we've been tracking, they have not missed school time or anything else. In fact, the parents seem to be more engaged as a result of this. And of course, that's one of the things we want to do with this too, is empower the parents and get them back in that parental role.
And do you take those jurors through any type of a training?
Yes. The next juror training for this will be the 18th from 3 until 5 here in council chambers, Monday the 18th.
And here's the thing: where we're at. We're in the growth stage, and exactly how this is going to be implemented. And it's going to grow from there, and hopefully expand. So we're moving that direction now, just building the foundation for where we're going. In the near future, we'll officially kick it off with the community interest out there, and hopefully we get some folks that are willing to participate with us. The other side of this is that it's kind of similar to back in years ago with the sheriff's department. They had like a juvenile incident form, and the detectives at the station handled it, and we diverted kids away from the court, okay, to not put them in the system based on a first-time offense. It's a similar thing to that. We want to broaden that to the schools, issues with truancy, those kind of things down the road. So it's going to be a developing program.
So it's determined at the detective level, as opposed to, for instance, the petty theft, shoplifting. Is it filed? I mean, is it sent to the DA's office and then the DA's determine?
No. Well, what happens is they send a case over to us. We contact the juvenile. If the juvenile and the parent want to participate in the program, then they don't file the charge. They just simply wait for us to get adjudication. If the juvenile does not successfully complete the program, and we tried our best to try to get them to cooperate, then the case goes back to the Sheriff's Department, and they go ahead and file a case down in juvenile court.
Is that similar to the JOIN program? Are you familiar with the JOIN program? Okay, because that to me, you're kind of duplicating that effort. I think there's a little different component, but it's kind of the same thing, where if a juvenile is arrested for a petty theft or first-time violation, that it's a type of diversion program where they are diverted to this program.
Well, there's several programs out there, like the Parent Project's one of them. There's a couple of them out there. It's just the JOIN program, as you're talking about the JOIN program, as formulated through the district attorney's office.
Right.
Yeah, I'm aware there's different names and acronyms out there for different programs, like the East LA Project is a branch of the Parent Project. It's similar. There's some certain components that are inclusive here that aren't part of that. The idea being is we're going to develop this as it suits our community needs here. Ideally, it's hopefully, like the Parent Project in Long Beach turned the truancy problem around about 93%. Okay, there's success. So, there's some things out there, and it's more of an intervention level type program. Jim's been putting this together for some time and has looked at multitude of programs out there and kind of taken the best thing from different programs out there and developing your own program. And that's, we do that with our community-based model too as well. People are doing different things.
You may want to look at that program too. I mean, it's local, and there are certain components of, you have to get good grades and you have to stay out of trouble and you can't have any, there's certain components of that program that might be helpful to yours.
Well, we have done a thing too as well from the high school district. We have an employee that actually sits in the juvenile court and provides the information for the student who's in court based on the conditions of their probation. And, and there's going to be some conditions as well that will develop out of this. Okay, and as it relates to that, one component all the time is, where is probation's involvement in this program? Is it preliminary, prior to going to court? What's the recommendation? That'll be a determination made mostly by who's making the referral, and then the suitability for that referral, the willingness of the people to participate in it, and how committed they are. And that'll base the success. But the ultimate thing is, if they don't, they go back to the regular system anyway.
As far as probation and the district attorney's involvement, is that a voluntary thing on their part, or is that?
We don't involve. We don't involve probation. In fact, that's one of the distinctions between us and the teen court the probation runs is we try to speed up the process because there's such a large window there usually between when the time of occurrence and when the juvenile actually goes to court, and it's hanging over their head for so long, and sometimes it's hard to see the relationship. Part of our goals within the program is to get the child in front of some type of authority within 30 days from the time of the offense, and that way they can see perhaps a relationship. The other thing that we're doing is we're following restorative justice principles, so we're trying to get the juvenile to the point to repair the damage it was done. In fact, one of the things I've been talking about with Lee and Dr. Vieira is if they send us a truant, can we look at the amount of time that the child was out of their seat, and can they reimburse the school district for that money? That repairs some of the damage that they've done. And under the bail schedule that was enacted by the city council when they adopted the budget, we actually have that authority to make them pay restitution as a condition of their probation, and things like that. If you've got a petty theft and you've got a known victim, and if the victim wants to participate and meet with the violator face to face, and then they can actually explain to the violator exactly what that did to him. You know, if somebody takes something out of that car in the driveway, they can explain what they had to go through, how they had to cancel this and cancel that, and how it just impacted their feeling of safety and security in their own residence, you know. And a lot of times kids don't think about that. They see the opportunity and they act. And this has been fairly successful not only here but back east as well. So
what we can do is at the next meeting we can bring a presentation forward, so we can give you a class example of someone from the beginning of the process and how it goes through it. Okay,
sounds,
and then
I'd
we
love
can
to
address
see that.
That and I you know I think we're looking forward to the it's going to develop as the program goes forward. Hopefully it becomes more inclusive of different entities out there, and it actually, you know, we're going to be able to qualify some success from it, and we can talk about that. The next one I'd like Don to talk to you about some issues we're having right now currently. Mr. Capel is not here, but some issues that relate to parole that we've been discussing with him, and this is pretty significant.
Morning. Better said standing. First of all, I want to tell you, I mean, I'm so impressed sitting over there and seeing where this commission has come. I mean, you guys get it. You guys are part of it, and all the acknowledgments that you guys are making as to the crime, this, that, the other, I've been doing this 28 years. You guys get it, and your input is right on. So I appreciate that, and I can see that this commission works and it's going in the right direction. With that being said, this is, I'm not coming to you for advice or help, really. I think this is more of informational subject matter. It's a subject that's near and dear to my heart because, I mean, we talk about a lot of crime, this, that, the other, but this is one of the things that really affects our community, and it's child molesters. You look back, and we've had so many problems recently with people that have been convicted of child molestation and gone to prison, and then they're released, and what do? They reoffend. It's a known fact that these guys are going to reoffend within 3 years from the time that they're released from prison. It's a known fact. I mean, how many times have we got to live through this? You know, J.C. DeGarde. I mean, we failed her. You know, the system has failed her. The government's failed her. Chelsea King, Amber Dubois. I mean, those are the recent ones. So that kind of prefaces what I want to talk about. But I got notified early this week that we're having an issue with a known child molester who moved from Pacoima to the city of Lancaster. And as part of the requirements of Penal Code 290 and another Penal Code 3000, they can't reside within 2,000 feet of a school or a daycare. But there is a judge that has decided that he will review that, and he's issued a formal document, a court document. It's called a writ of habeas corpus that allows this child molester to live a half block from an elementary school. And it's problematic. I mean, obviously you can see that I'm upset about this whole thing, that we're even allowing this. First of all, that he's moved from Pacoima. Second of all, that he's still being supervised by a parole office downtown, not even locally. The local office wasn't aware that he was here. I mean, there's bells going off in my head all over the place that this is going to create problems. And if this is what's going to happen, we need to do something about it. So Lee DiRico and myself and the captain, we are all going to talk with the Undersecretary of Parole, and this is going to be one of the main topics of our discussion. And we're going to move forward to see what we can do about stopping this type of, just abuse of the system, I guess, because how you can do this. And this guy, I can't give you the full information on it, but I'll tell you, this guy, since he's been released from prison, he's been violated 6 times for absconding from parole. He doesn't like to be supervised. But we're going to let him come up here and live on the same street where we've got an elementary school and not be supervised. Because I can tell you, the people down in L.A. aren't going to drive up here and check on him. And I can tell you about, GPS. GPS is a good thing, but it's only as good as the person operating the system. J.C. DeGarde, that Philip Garrido, when he was on GPS, over 400 times that thing went off, that it was had a bad connection. And then they looked, and there was a huge pattern that this guy was spending evenings in his backyard. But did they ever go over there? No. Parole never checked on that for years. So GPS is only as good as who's watching it. So I guess I'll get off my soapbox.
The other issue with this is that it's our understanding, and that will be part of the discussion. And the captain and Don and I have met with Mr. Kernan in the past over issues. It's our understanding that the recommendation to go seek out this judge for this writ is being recommended by an internal supervisor in their agency. Okay? Because obviously management of the 290 offenders is a significant cost for their agency, and it seems though as there's a direct correlation between cost and everything that's going on with them right now. We have the diminished ability for the agents to be able to come out and work with the Sheriff's Department and this parolee apprehension team. So we're just making you aware there's some things that we're going to be doing here in the near future to try and work these issues out with them, and then we'll bring that forward to you. And then at some point here, if it's necessary for the commission to make, if we don't get compliance, obviously we're going to seek out some type of document from the commission or something you will collaborate on and advise the city council on a direction we need to go.
Was the judge who submitted the writ of habeas corpus local or
no,
down in L.A.?
No, Los Angeles. So you got to remember, we're supervised out of Region 3, which is run out, is it at Pasadena, Axel, is where the main Region 3 office is, and it's inclusive of a good portion of downtown as well. So this is something we've discussed with them in the past, that we'd like to be in Region 4, which is more of, Victorville, San Bernardino County, Kern County districts, because we think it's more conducive to us here, and that it's more of a localized parole force that would be managing our area. That's some ongoing discussions we have. But again, there's some huge budget issues right now for that agency, and that's their focus. So I will definitely respond back to you as how that went. And the captain was very animated in our last meeting, and I expect that again. and we'll see where it goes.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
State court or federal district court?
I'll get the details. The individual that brought it forward has a copy of the writs.
Has the district attorney's office appealed the ruling?
Well, it hasn't gone that far yet, that I'm aware of, Commissioner Brown, because the DA's office, this is after sentencing, release on supervised parole. The DA's office is not even involved in that at this point. Now, I'm sure that we're going to make them aware when we actually see what is going on here, and we'll go from that point.
Lee, I have one question, and that was Lieutenant had mentioned that you guys are going to schedule a meeting with the Undersecretary. When is that meeting planned?
Well, we were going to try and do it on the telephone tomorrow. Okay, so it's very near, and trying to set that time up to have a phone conference. Last time we had a discussion, he came down with members of his staff to meet with us. Senator Runner got involved the last time in our last discussion and helped us get that meeting together, so that's the direction we're going to go now.
If something occurs on the status of this prior to our next meeting, could you, in some manner, maybe through Britt,
Absolutely.
Let the commission know where that stands?
Yes. Okay. And with that, okay. I think we're pretty much updated on some things we're doing. We've got other stuff going on out there, but this one's a high priority for us.
Thank you. Okay, public business from the floor, non-agendized items? Any?
I don't have any speaker cards.
Okay.
Well, I did have one thing, yes. Mr. Chairman. I'm sorry, because this is really important. Marv, why are you looking at me like that? He's concerned. Okay. No, this is a good thing. Through our Weed and Seed program, and I'm sorry I didn't mention this, but, you know, we've had some individuals coming to the commission and indicating that we don't have any kind of reentry program for our parolees or non-revocable parole. Well, as a matter of fact, at the beginning of our meeting, they just happened to be graduating 25 former members of our community who were incarcerated now are graduating from their reentry program through the Weed and Seed program. And that was taking place. This is our third graduation, is that correct, Don? We started with 6, and then we had 7 the last one. This was 25.
Yeah, there was 6, then there was 12, and this is 20.
Okay. So 25 individuals today that have gone through that program, through our Weed and Seed program, and going through their job skills training, how to fill out an application, got them a suit, okay, and are gone through that process. So we actually do, besides CDCR's reentry program, we also have one sponsored here in the community. And I know that's been portrayed that we didn't. We've been telling you we have it. Now we actually had folks, and we're going to bring a presentation to you. We actually have a staff member over videotaping that graduation, and we'll bring that forward.
Mr. DiRico, I met yesterday with the president of ALADS, and he was saying that ALADS would like to donate to our local Weed and Seed because it's been so successful. So
that'd
can
be
you
great.
Can you touch base with him and
yes, sir.
See what they need to do?
That it?
That's it. I'm sorry.
Thank you very much. Okay. Commissioner comments. Any comments from any of our commissioners in closing? I guess my only comment is that I had a ball over the weekend, and I got to give credit to the city of Lancaster for putting on such an enjoyable Grand Prix. Had the opportunity to race. Would like to have said I did better, but I'll do better next year. And looking forward to, again, like fellow commissioners, hopefully representing the Criminal Justice Commission in that race in 2011. So, thank you.
Just to comment on that, the deputies did an amazing job. Our staff was amazing. And I have to just, you know, not being that familiar with how they put things together, what a great team effort. But we had nothing happen. And I mean, with amazing people, we had 35,000 people through the weekend here, and we had a couple lost kids. And then I had one senior that somehow got from Sacred Heart Church over to the district office building and didn't know how to get back. That was it, really. I mean, I can't think of anything noteworthy that occurred. I think the participation level out there for the community was great. And it's pretty tough to put on a 3-day deal like that and have the bands and all the participation we had and not have an incident. And that was, the deputies were mobile, walking everywhere, our staff members, CSOs working this thing. It was an, it went really well. And so just.
Very enjoyable event. With no further comments, we stand adjourned at 12:00.